everyone, welcome back to my class. This is Mehjabeen Fatima, a teacher at Ahlebat High School and Junior College. In our previous class, we have studied about the second chapter of Social Studies of 7th Standard. Now, in this session, we are going to proceed with our third chapter, that is Tanks and Groundwater. This chapter consists of two parts. Now, let's proceed with our first part. Let's proceed with our lesson. So, first one is tank. So, another name of tanks is Cheruvulu. So, for thousands of years, our ancestors have tried to utilize runoff rainwater by building tanks. So, before 1000 years, our ancestors, they were trying to utilize runoff rainwater by building tanks. We have evidence of tanks being built and used for agriculture from the times of the megaliths. So, we have the evidence that tanks are being built and used for agriculture purpose from the times of megaliths. You will also read about the Kakatiya kings who built a large number of tanks in Telangana. This enabled the extension of agriculture into dry regions. To this day, most of the villages in these regions have at least one or two major tanks. So, with the help of tanks, our agriculture has also been improved. And these tanks are being used as irrigation process in our agriculture. And in our Telangana, Kakatiya kings, they built several tanks which helps our region for agriculture purpose. And this enabled the extension of agriculture into the dry regions as well. So, wherever the regions they are dry, these tanks are being used for agriculture purpose. Now, let's see how were the tanks built. The tanks were usually built by building a strong wall of stones and mud across a small stream in such a way that with a wall on just one side, a large lake could be formed. So, tanks are being built by building a strong wall of stones. So, these tanks are made up of strong walls of stones and mud across a small stream in such a way with a wall on just one side. So, on one side there will be a wall and this tank will be built with a strong stones and mud across a stream. Tanks were sometimes built by a king, sometimes by a military leader or nayaka, or often by the people of the village themselves. So, these tanks are being built by the king sometimes and by military leader sometimes, or nayaka, or often by the people of the village themselves. According to the requirement, these people, they are going to build the tank. Usually, every village preserved the memory of those who were responsible for building the tank through stories or temples or festivals. So, every village is having a memory of those who were responsible for building the tank through the stories or temples or festivals. In building the tank, everyone in the village contributed towards the expenses and labor. So, this tank is not being built by a single person. Every person who, according to their requirement, whoever is involved in building the tank, they are contributing the money for expenses and labor. All the people of the village maintained the tank together by repairing the tank bund or removing silt from the tank bed. The people, they are going to take care of the tank as it is very much useful for them. So, whatever the maintenance it required, these people, they are together ready to come out with that problem. And these people, they are together repairing the tank if required. And they are also removing the silt from the tank bed. They also ensured that no one stopped the water from flowing into the tank. They also appointed a person to regulate the use of the water from the tank. This particular person is called Nirati or Niru Katte Manisi. So, these people, those who are involved in building the tank and taking the necessary precautions to maintain the tank, they have appointed a person who is responsible to regulate the use of the water from the tank, and that particular person is called as Nirati. So, Nirati or Niru Katte Manasi is the person who is responsible to use of the water from tank. How did the tanks help? Now, let's see how these tanks are helping the villagers or persons who are living in that particular village and who are using the tanks. So, how did the tanks are helping the villagers? So, tanks help the people not only by giving them and their animals drinking water but also in irrigating their fields in such a way that even during drought years they could raise at least some crops. Tanks also help to increase the water level in the wells nearby. So these tanks, they are not only helping the people by giving them and their animals drinking water, but also they are providing the irrigation facility to the agriculture. And during the drought years, these tanks are very helpful for growing crops as well, and they could raise at least some crops during the drought years. And the tanks are also helping the people to increase the water level in the wells which are nearby to the tanks. After the rain stopped and the tank water decreased, the tank bed could be used for raising some crops. So when the rain will stop, the tank water will also get, and the tank bed can be used for raising some crops. Means in the tank bed there will be some water that can be used for raising some crops. The most important thing is that tanks help to prevent runoff of rainwater and the erosion of topsoil. So the important thing is that these tanks, they are helping to prevent runoff of rainwater and erosion of topsoil. The erosion which will be there on the top of the soil, that will also be reduced. And every year people would collect tank silt and use it in their fields to fertilize the soil. So these people, they are cleaning the tank silt every year, and that tank silt is being used in the agricultural fields as fertilizers. We should remember that no one person owned the tanks, and they belong to all of the people of the village. Thus they benefited not one or two people but all the villagers. So as we have discussed, this tank is not being built by a single person. Every person from the village, they are getting together and they are building these tanks for their requirement. And this tank is not owned by a single person, we can say. And it belongs to all the persons who are contributed to build the tank. So all of the people, they get benefited with this tank. Not one or two people, all the peoples of the village, they are getting benefited with this tank. Let's see decline of tanks in our times. So nowadays we can see these tanks have been declined. Now let's see what is the reason behind the declining of the tanks. During the last 20 or 30 years, tanks have been neglected and have been allowed to break down. Repairs to the tanks, desilting, etc. have not been done regularly. People also have gradually taken over the tank land for building houses or for agriculture. So we can say that during last 20 or 30 years, tanks have been neglected and have not been allowed to be used, and they have been allowed to break down, and repairs of the tanks, desilting, etc. have not been done regularly. And the reason for this is the people, they have gradually taken over the tank land for building houses or for agriculture. So the land which they were using for building the tanks, that particular land they have used for building the houses and for agriculture purpose. Means they have neglected the tanks, and there on that land they are building the houses and they are keeping that land for agriculture purpose. As a result, in almost every part of the state we see that the sad slate of dry tanks lying uncared for. So as a result to this, in almost every part of the state we can see that sad state of dry tanks lying uncared for. So when we will see to every village, we can see that a sad state of dry tanks lying uncared for means these tanks, they are dried up. As the peoples of the village, they are not using these tanks, so these tanks have been dried up and they are lying uncared. Instead of caring for the tanks, we have been digging deeper and deeper tube wells at a great expense. So instead of caring for these tanks, what the people they are doing, they are being digging deeper and deeper tube wells, so that to get water they are digging the land deeper and deeper with great expense. As this tube wells, they are taking much expenses when compared to the tanks. So instead of digging these wells, if we are using the tanks, or if we are repairing the tanks which have already been built, that will be much beneficial for us, we can say. But they only benefit a few, and in the long run deplete the water resources. On the other hand, tanks build resources for all. So when we will see these tube wells, they are only benefited for a few, and in the long run deplete the water resources, means the water resources will be depleted by using the tube wells. And on the other hand, when we will see the tanks, they are built as resource for all. Let's see about fishing in tanks. Tanks not only provide drinking water and water for irrigation of fields, but also provide livelihood for fisher folk. Many of the fisher folk are from traditional fishing communities like Besta, Gangaputra, Gondla and Mudiraj, that is Telugu community, depend upon these tanks and rivers for leading their lives. So these tanks, they are not only benefited for irrigation or for drinking purpose, but they are also being beneficial for the fisher folk, means for the livelihood of fisher folk. And many of the fisher folk, they are from traditional fishing communities like Besta, Gondla and Mudiraj community. They depend upon these tanks and rivers for leading their lives. Let's find out more about their lives by visiting a village in Suryapet district. Now let's discuss about a village that is Suryapet district so that we can learn more about this fisher folks and more about this usage of tanks. So the name of the village is Bhethovolu village. This village is 16 kilometers from Kodada near Suryapet. So this village is about 16 kilometers from Kodada near Suryapet. And according to the village elders, Bhethovolu got its name from Bethala Reddy, the subordinate of Kakatiyas. So according to the elders of the village, this Bhethovolu got its name from the Bethala Reddy, who was from the Kakatiya dynasty. Kakatiya was South Indian dynasty. So this Bhethovolu got its name from the Bethala Reddy, who was the subordinate of Kakatiyas. He got the tank built in the name of his wife Veerala Devi. Thus the villagers call the large tank as Veerala Devi tank for Erla Devi tank. So this Bethala Reddy, he has built a tank by the name of his wife, that is Veerala Devi. So the villagers, now they are calling the tank as Veerala Devi tank or Erla Devi tank. The tank irrigates about 1900 acres in the village today, even though originally it was meant to irrigate about 3000 acres. So nowadays this tank, it is irrigating about 1900 acres in the village today, and before it was built with the view of irrigating 3000 acres. The Ayakat, that is command area of tank, has been reduced due to illegal encroachments on the tank bed and due to silting. On the tank bend is situated the shrines of Katta, Maisamma and Gangamma, who considered the guardian duties of the tank. Fisher folk and other villagers worship in these shrines before fishing and also celebrate annual festivals in their honor. So this tank bend, it is situated on the shrines of Katta, Maisamma and Gangamma. They were considered as the guardians deities of the tank, and the fisher folks and other villagers worship these shrines before fishing and also celebrate the annual festival in their honor. There are about 600 families of Besta, Gangaputra and Mudiraj community in Bhethovolu village. So there are about 600 families who are living in Besta and Gudiraj community in Bhethovolu village, out of which 60 to 70 households are leading their lives by fishing. So 60 to 70% of the lives from this village, they are leading their lives by fishing. And however, they fish in the tank only during the months of March and April. During the rest of the year, they work as small farmers or laborers. And that season will be in the month of March and April. And during the rest of the year, they are working as a laborers or small farmers in the agricultural fields. Fishes in the tanks. Earlier, different kinds of fishes like Buddha Parakalu, జెలలు, కోడిపెలు, చందమందలు, కుంటు ముక్కలు, ఉలిషలు, ఇసుక, డొండులు, పెపరలు, గాంధ్ర, పరకలు, గురియో పిల్లలు, కోరముంటులు, వెలుగలు, ఎక్సెట్రా. సో దీస్ ఆర్ ది టైప్స్ ఆఫ్ ది ఫిషెస్ విచ్ క్యాన్ బి ఫౌండ్ ఇన్ దిస్ విలేజ్ అండ్ వెర్ ఈజీలీ అవైలబుల్ ఇన్ ద స్ట్రీమ్స్, స్మాల్ రివర్స్ అండ్ కెనాల్స్. సో దీస్ టైప్స్ ఆఫ్ ఫిషెస్, దే ఆర్ ఈజీలీ అవైలబుల్ ఇన్ స్మాల్ స్ట్రీమ్స్ అండ్ రివర్స్ అండ్ కెనాల్స్. వెన్ దీస్ వాటర్ ఫ్లోట్ ఇన్ టు ద tanks, the fishes breed in them. But during the recent times, these fishes are disappearing due to heavy usage of pesticides and chemical fertilizers in the agricultural fields. So these fishes can be found very easily before, but now when we will see, Due to the heavy usage of chemical fertilizers and pesticides, these fishes are being eradicated or being disappeared from these tanks. So now the young fish are bred artificially in fish farming centers and are let out as seedlings into the tank. So nowadays what the villagers they are doing, they are taking the young fish and they are breeding that fish artificially in fish farming centers and they are letting out the seedlings into the tank. When they grow big, they are fished and sold. The important among these are mirage, ravu boche and bangara. These fishes are mainly available in the market nowadays. So the important fishes among all these fishes are merige, ravu boche and bangaru. And these fishes, they are mainly available in the market nowadays. Each fish has its own special taste. Have you tasted the above mentioned fishes? So he is asking, have you tasted the above fishes, as each fish is having its own taste. Net types. The fishermen use nets of different kinds to catch the fish. There would be 30 kannalu in small parisha, where 60 kannalu in big parisha. These nets are also called as sanapu vala and doddu vala in some areas. So the fishermen, they are using different kinds of nets to catch the fishes. And there would be 30 kannulu, that is 30 holes in small parisha. Small parisha is thinner net, whereas in 60 kannulu means 60 holes will be there in big parisha. That will be thicker net. And these nets, they are also called as sanapu wala and doddu wala in some areas. So in some areas, the people, they are calling these nets as sanapu wala and doddu wala. The nets contain the beads made by either iron or lead. The sanapu wala weighs less. So these nets, they are containing the beads which is made by the iron or lead, and they catch fishes and prawns by sanapu wala. Doddu wala is used to catch the fish of weight 100 grams to 5 kilos. So sanapu wala, that is a thicker net, that net will be used for catching the small fishes and prawns, whereas doddu wala is the thicker nest that is being used to catch the fish which has weight of 100 grams to 5 kilos. Doddu wala weighs more. Can you think why? Fisher folk use two methods to catch fish. One is shallow waters and one is deep waters. So the fishermen, they are using the two methods for catching the fishes. The first one is shallow waters and the another one is deep waters. Vizayar wala is used when there is less water in the tank. Kochalu wala weight less. So vizayar wala is also a type of a net which is being used when there is less water in the tank. Kochalu wala weighs less. Fisherman goes and spread the kochalu wala. These are used mostly in the occasions where the water is deep. So the fishermen, they are spreading the kochalu wala net, and these nets, they are being used mostly on the occasions where the water is deep. Let's discuss about fishing. The fishermen start for fishing early in the morning. Some use vizayar wala for the fishing on the tanks where the water is not deep. Others go into the lake on a ferry made with thermocol and reach a place where water is very deep and spread the kochalu wala. So fishermen, they are starting from fishing early in the morning. So early in the morning, they will wake up and they will go for the fishing, where they are using vizayar wala for the fishing on the banks where the water is not very much deep. Others go onto the lake on a ferry made with a thermocol and reach a place where water is very deep and spread the kochalu wala. So other people, they are going to the lake on a ferry. Ferry is a kind of a ship, we can say, that is made up of a thermocol that they are using to reach into the lake, and after reaching that place, they are spreading the kochalu wala to catch the fishes. Fishing is done twice a day. They catch the fish from 4 o'clock to 8 o'clock in the morning and take them to market. So these people, they are doing fishing twice in a day, and they are catching fishes from 4 o'clock to, and after that they are taking those fishes to the market for selling them. Again, they catch fishes from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the afternoon and take them to market. So first shift was from 4 to 8 in the early morning, and next shift is from 1 to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and after catching the fishes, they are taking those fishes to the market for selling those fishes. Don't care for cold rains and heat, and do the fishing and these people they are not caring for cold and rain. Instead of cold and instead of rain, these people they are catching the fishes. The fish left over after the sale are washed neatly and dried under the sun. Whatever the fishes they are leftovers, they are taking those fishes and they are washing them neatly and they are drying up those fishes under the sun. When the catch is small, they take them to Kodad or Suryapet for selling, and when it is large, they take it cities like Hyderabad. So when the catch is very much small, they are taking them to the Kodad or Suryapet for selling the fishes, and when the catch is very much large, they are taking those fishes to the cities like Hyderabad. Usually it is the men who do the fishing and it is the women who do the selling in the market. So usually what happens is the men they will go for fishing and the women they are going for selling those fishes in the market. Let's see about the cooperative societies of fishermen. A family needs to have a membership in the cooperative society for fishing. So every family they need to have a membership in the cooperative society for fishing. The membership is decided on the basis of the ayakat. Usually the society takes one member per 1 hectare, 2.5 acres. There are 339 members in the society today. So the membership is decided on the basis of ayakat, and these societies they take one member per 1 hectare, we can say, and there are 339 members in the society today. The societies pays 2,35,000 to the Department of Fisheries for fishing in the tank. So these societies they are paying 2,35,000 to the Department of Fisheries for fishing in the tank. The society has to purchase fish seedlings and put them into the tank. So these societies has to take the seedlings and they are putting them into the tanks. They are supposed to pool and produce and share the earnings equally among all members. So whatever the earning will be there, that earning will be equally shared by all the members of that society. Recently, a new practice can be seen in many fishing tanks. The fishermen are too poor and need loans for running their households. So recently, there emerged a new practice that can be seen in many fishing tanks, and the fishermen they are too poor and need loans for running their households. They cannot afford to buy the fish seedlings from the dish farms. Hence, they are forced to take loans from traders. The fishermen they are very much poor and they cannot afford for running their households and they cannot afford to buy these seedlings from the fish farms. Now they are being forced to take the loans from traders. Traders give advance loans and also takes the responsibility of putting seedlings in the tank. So these traders they are taking the loan in advance and they are taking the responsibility of putting the seedlings in the tank. And in return the fisher folk have to sell all their produce to the trader at a price fixed by him, which is usually about 10 to 20% of the actual market price. So in return the person or the fisher folk who is fishing, he has to sell all his produce to the traders at a price which is fixed by the trader himself and which is usually about 10 to 20% of the actual price in the market. And in this way, the trader makes a huge profit. If banks could give loans to the cooperative societies, the fishermen could become independent of this trader contractor. So if the bank is helping these fisher folks by giving them loans, so these cooperative society can be easily come out from the trader contractors. So this was all about our third chapter, part 1, that was tank. Let's discuss about groundwater, that is part 2 in our next class. Thank you.